sound of dry bones rattling.
As I was commanded, and as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to it, Sovereign Lord says, come breath from the four winds and breathe into these slain that they may live.
Live, live, dry bones in the word of the Lord. Live, 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 dry bones in the word of the Lord. Live, live, dry bones in the word of the Lord. Live, live, live.
Well, good morning, church. Good morning. I'm going to invite you to go ahead and be standing as we jump into worship this morning. Let's sing out this morning as we worship our God and the thankfulness we have for Him, and just praising Him and asking Him to restore our spirits this morning. Restore my spirit, Lord, I need restored. My heart is weary, please help me, dear Lord. I stand in need of more strength from your word. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul. Revive the fire, Lord, deep in my soul. Stir my desire to work in your fold. Light in my heart, dear God, your zeal grown cold. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul. And renew my courage, Lord, it needs restored. My cup is empty, refill it, dear Lord. Replace all doubts and fear with faith so bold. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul. So restore my spirit, Lord, I need restored. My heart is weary, please help me, dear Lord. I stand in need of more strength from your word. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. And when we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Serving every day, just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. And when we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. And when we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the
y'all be seated.
Hey Gateway, thanks so much for joining us for worship. Here are some things to highlight for you. We will be dedicating Christmas poinsettias for our loved ones this year. You can fill out the form and pay at the North Connect Center in the gathering area. The community outreach is collecting new or gently used coats and blankets of all sizes starting now until December 10th. These items will be distributed at our second Saturday meal on December 11th. Please make sure all blankets are lightweight and small enough to be rolled and carried. All donations can be brought to the community outreach closet located in the gym. If you have any questions, please see Derek Hancock. Our Children's Ministry Christmas Program and Sanctuary will be held on December 19th. We hope to see you there. If you grabbed an ornament from the Christmas tree for our foster care Christmas drive, Please be sure to turn in your gifts to the office during the week or to the table set up by the cafe during our gathering times. Thank you all so much for your incredible generosity. The Soul Sisters Christmas Party will be taking place December 11th at 5:30 p.m. here at the building. Make sure you save the date and be listening out for more details. If you would like to order a Gateway Children's Ministry t-shirt for $10, the deadline is today. You can order them at the Connect Center or see Elizabeth Tomlinson for more details. If you would like more info with anything happening at Gateway, please drop by the Connect Center and talk to a team member. We hope you have a fantastic week.
Great morning.
Good
morning. Welcome to Gateway Church of Christ. Tell you what, it is good to see you all here. Hopefully you had a great week of Thanksgivings, and hopefully it did not take you too long to see those blessings in your life that we lift back up to God and give Him thanks for that. We are a church here that loves God first and foremost, and then that drives us to love one another. And then that even further drives us to have a deeper relationship with God and with each other. That's our vision statement. So members, as you are here, thank you for being part of that vision statement and your mission in it is very needed, and we appreciate that very much. Guests, if you are out there, and there are a lot of guests out here today, please understand that you are a special honored guest. We love seeing you here. Thank you for being here, and give us the time that allow us a little time to get to know you before you get on out of here today. This is a community church. This is a church that we love to come together and commune with God and commune with each other. So if you're a guest out there, we like to just call you future family. No pressure, but please feel free to reach out to one of us and learn more about Gateway Church of Christ. We'd love to explain it to you. We are in, the cliche is, right, the season of go, right? Feels like we've been in it for a little while. If you look at the retail stores, we've been celebrating Christmas for about 4 months now, right? So we're in a culture of just get to the next place. Go. And if you're like me, sometimes you're guilty of rushing to get to something, in so much of a rush that you basically rush through that very thing that you're rushing to. And then you look back and you're like, man, where did that go? I just didn't, you know, Thanksgiving was just a few days ago. It just seemed like that, right? Next thing you know, we're going to be celebrating Christmas. And next thing you know, it'll be summer again. But we just seem to rush to get to the next day. I'm going to ask you just to slow down. I'm just going to ask you to take a breath and enjoy the journey. Enjoy where God has you today. Enjoy the day that He has given you today and the blessings that are in it. Do not rush through that. And the one thing that we should never feel like we should have to rush through is worship. This is the time that we come together and we breathe with each other, right? We commune with God's Spirit here and with each other. This is the one time where we do just need to chill a little bit, relax, and enjoy the time that we have together. I'm going to read to you from 1 Chronicles 16. Ascribe to the Lord, all you families of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Bring an offering and come before Him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of His holiness. Tremble before Him, all the earth. The world is firmly established. It cannot be moved. Let the heavens rejoice. Let the earth be glad. Let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Let the sea resound and all that is in it. Let the fields be jubilant and everything in them. Let the trees of the forest sing. Let them sing for joy before the Lord, for He comes to judge the earth. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. Cry out, save us, God our Savior. Gather us and deliver us from the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name and glory in your praise. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Then all the people said, Amen, and praise the Lord. All right, let's stand up. Let's greet each other this morning in all of God's splendor, recognizing him for who he is, and let's recognize the relationships we are to each other.
Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me ever to adore thee, may I still thy shaken. Give thanks to the Lord, for we all now can stand and fear not of being forsaken. Give thanks to the Lord for his righteousness. Give thanks to the Lord for his love. Let us worship his name and his holiness. Give thanks to the Lord. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Give thanks. Give
thanks to the Father for sending His Son. Give thanks to the Son for the Spirit. Now lift up your voices to God, three in one, and shout so the whole world can hear it. And give thanks to the Lord for His righteousness. Give thanks to the Lord for His love. Let us worship His name and His holiness. Give thanks to the Lord. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord for His righteousness. Give thanks to the Lord for His love. Let us worship His name and His holiness. Give thanks to the Lord. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Give thanks. Give thanks.
Give thanks, church. Amen, amen. Y'all can be seated.
Good morning. Would you bow with me? Father God, we come to You in awe. You are God. You are everything. Your Father, Son, Holy Spirit, You are our Creator, our hope, our guarantee. You're God. Lord, we come to You as children to petition You. You know our names. You know who we are. You know every hair on our head. You know what we want. You know what we need. You know our heartbreaks. You know our joys. You know the grief of the Beaver family, the Stewarts, the Graham families. You know the health of Randy, Michaela, Judy, Debbie, and others in our group, and everyone in this world, billions. You know everything. You know our children's names and our favorite aunt, and You know us. You sent Jesus because You know us and You know what we need, and we thank You. Bless this morning, accept our offer of worship and our time, and help us to go out of this building and continue to worship with our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Obviously, during this time of year, there's a lot of eating going on. And may or may not make you feel good. But we are gathering around a table this morning, as we do every week, to feast upon the bread and the cup, an eternal food that does make us feel so good. Amen. And we sing this song, What a Beautiful Name. We're going through the sermon series Just Like Him, and the title of the lesson this morning is He Knows Your Name. And amen that He does know our name. And we know His. And it's a beautiful name. It's a wonderful name. It's a powerful name. And there's power in that name. So as we gather around the table this morning, let's think about the power that we have in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's all stand.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in You are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us,
'Cause Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. And what could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. And death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival, and you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. And yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. And what a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. And you have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign.
Lift your voice.
Yours is the kingdom, and yours is the glory. And yours is a name above all names. And what a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Amen. Be seated.
Isn't it joyful to be here and be in the gathering area and see all the relationships that are growing out there? It's just the blessing that we hoped it would be and more. There's a passage in Hebrews that this reminds me of. In Hebrews 10, let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more you see the day approaching. This passage in Hebrews reminds us that we each have a special need to meet together as a collective body of believers. Christians are to encourage each other, to develop unity, to share concerns, and also lean on one another for support and assistance. It's simply, if simply meeting together as Christians can help us develop these caring attitudes, how much more more powerful and more effective is meeting together as a family around the Lord's table. In the book of Acts, we read that the special bond that Christians have with one another is unique, especially when we gather together at the communion time. And from Acts 2, verse 46 and 47, every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. The word communion means fellowship and refers to a special bond. The bond formed and sustained by the communion feast is certainly one we have with the Lord, but is also a special bond we share with one another. The Lord's Supper reminds us of that mutual bond. Christ did not just die for me, but for those around me as well. As we pass the bread, we remember that the body of Jesus Christ was beaten and torn, both for me and my brother. As we pass the cup, we remember that the blood of Jesus was shed for my sister as well as for me. The communion bonds me with my brothers and sisters in Christ, as nothing else in the worship service does, because God so loved the world, he gave his Son. Bow with me. Father God, as we take this bread, let us take it and say as we take the bread itself, looking at one another and saying, this is his body, broken for me and for you. Amen. And now as we take the cup, Father, as we take this cup, we ask that you bless us and have us look at one another and say, this is his blood shed for me and for you. Amen.
One of the great joys about this church is how giving you all are. Within days of us placing the tree out for our annual foster children gift program that we do each year, every single ornament was gone, and we had to add more, and we had to add more, and within 24 hours of us adding, they were all gone. All those ornaments are gone, gifts are beginning to pile in, and this Christmas, a lot of children will receive those gifts from their foster families and won't go giftless this Christmas. That is the spirit and the joy of this church. It is also the desired spirit of God when he says for us, those who believe in him and belong to his kingdom, to give back from what we've been given. It's at this time we take a time in our worship to contribute to the joy of giving. So the front left of each segment, if you will grab that basket, pass it to your right, and then all the way back, and the ushers will collect that offering after this prayer. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for the blessing that you give us. You richly bless us with so many things, and we, at this time, joyfully give back to you from what we've been prospered. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
As I mentioned earlier, the title of Jeremy's sermon today is He Knows Your Name. And in a world that can feel very lonely and dark, as we go throughout our lives and our jobs and school, maybe feeling like nobody around us really truly knows our name or knows who we are, we serve a Savior who does know our name. And for that reason, we can walk and stand boldly without fear. Amen. Let's all stand as we sing this song before we hear from Jeremy.
You hear me when I call. You are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still, whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me, and I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. My strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me. Yours is the victory. Whom shall I fear? And whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me, and I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. And nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hands, and I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful.
Let's lift our hands.
And nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hands, and I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. I know who goes before me, and I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Amen, amen. Be seated.
There's a lot that's in a name. And God knows your name. In the Old Testament, you weren't simply named because a name sounded cool. You typically carried a meaning behind your name. My name, Jeremy, is derived from the name Jeremiah. It means God's anointed. That's pretty cool. Jennifer, my beautiful wife, means fair one, fair one. Abby Grace, Abigail, means a father's joy. Connor means a lover of hound dogs. We really just like that name. Matter of fact, even Tyler, poor Tyler, one who lays tile. I was like, man, we did not do the dudes well in this relationship, but it's all right. I know that most of you poured a lot into names, naming your children. I've heard stories where like siblings would not talk to each other anymore because one of them had a child before the other one and they stole the name. You heard of that? Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, you grow up as a little girl and you're writing the name of your future child and you just happen to show your sister or your brother and they're like, you know, I like that name. I'm going to take it. Or in my family, we have three Sarahs. So they were like, I don't care what you name her. I'm going to name her Sarah anyway. So that can become very confusing at Thanksgiving time. But the whole point is there is meaning behind the name. And there's beauty in this title, this idea that he knows your name, that Jesus actually knows your name. Now, does he know or did he know that my name was going to be Jeremy when I was born? Did he know that? I mean, the Bible does say to Jeremiah the prophet, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. I knew you. I anointed you to set you apart, to proclaim God's word to the people of Israel. And so they had meaning. They had kind of this expectation that, well, this is what he's going to end up doing. He's going to fulfill his name. And if I were to put money on it, I would bet that there are many of you here who have lost confidence in your name. And maybe not your name specifically, but maybe your identity. Maybe you, like others, started out with a lot of promise. You know, one of the things that I always used to feel very confident in was that the Coon family in Anniston, Alabama was kind of a dynasty. We were. I mean, my dad was an elder in the church. My dad was very influential in the community. We were very active in our church. We were also very active in the community. I remember when people would come to us, they would talk to us. They would talk to me about my grandfather because they saw that I had a gift of speaking, and my grandfather was a preacher for 70 years, and so they were like, you're following in his footsteps. And I remember saying these kind of quasi-blessings being said over us. And I remember how much pride I kind of took in that. Well, I knew when I went to church, I was kind of the popular family. I was kind of the part of that. And so I carried that with honor, with integrity. And then years later, my parents would divorce. And a lot of that dynastic feeling that you had became kind of an embarrassment. It became kind of sad. And when I'd go home, it was instead of it being a reminder that I'm proud of this generation of loving the Lord and doing great things, I was now kind of reminded of the brokenness of our family. And so there wasn't as much pride in the name now that I knew that this name had now changed within the community. And now when people talked about the Coon family, they talked about us in a different light. Maybe you were very proud of yourself at some point. Maybe you had promise. You were highly intelligent. You were good in school. People said you were going to do great things. Maybe I should stop talking about that point. That was weird. But somewhere down the line, what the enemy likes to do is he likes to give you a different name. He likes to say, I know you take pride in this, but your name is really liar. Your name is adulterer. Your name is sinner. Your name is almost got there, but not quite. Your name is failure. Your name is bankruptcy. Your name is needy. And Satan plants these words in our hearts, in our lives, and we begin to know that there is a truth in some of that name. We all know our flaws many times better than we know our strengths. Because we believe it deep down inside, and then when the enemy understands that we believe that, he capitalizes on it and he whispers into our ear, this is who you really are. And we kind of go through this psychological name change, if you will. Well, the producers of The Chosen kind of picked up on this, and they ran with it. And they used it in the scenario where Jesus casts out these demons from Mary Magdalene. And so I want to take you to that scene. But you need to understand, at the beginning of the scene, she's going to be known by a different name. This is not a biblical name, but she's known to those within her community as Lilith.
I don't know what else I can do to help you.
Give me that. Lots of it.
That's not going to solve your problems. It's meant to distract from
them. No more preaching. Just give it to me.
Lilith, please listen to what I'm saying.
I said leave.
It's not for you.
Don't touch me.
Oh. Lily. Lily. Lily, are you okay?
I have to go. Leave me alone.
Mary. Mary of Magdala. Says the Lord who created you, and he who formed you. Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine.
The idea of the importance of this scripture is what actually happened. So we first go to Luke chapter 8, 1 through 3. After this, Jesus traveled about from town, one town and village to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him. And also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases, Mary called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had come out. Joanna, the wife of Chuza, the manager of Herod's household, Susanna, and many others, these women were helping to support them out of their own means. Women following Jesus, the Messiah. That wasn't a typical practice. Women didn't follow rabbis. It was something that Jewish male children did through Torah school and those things. But this was something foreign, something almost shameful to a degree. Mark also records it. It says this of Mary Magdalene. When Jesus rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had driven seven demons. Is that it? That's it. That's all the scripture talks about in regards to this occurrence that Jesus has with Mary where he drives out these demons. So what do we know about Mary? Well, here's one thing. We know that Mary's name is mentioned in many cases more time than some of Jesus' actual disciples. We know she was Mary of Magdala. What is Magdala? Magdala is a town on the northwest or northeast portion, I can't remember off the top of my head, of Tiberias or the Sea of Galilee. Matter of fact, it's recently thought to have been discovered. When we were there, it had been recently been discovered, and they were doing all this archaeological excavation on this town, largely thought to be a place where the fish would come in and they would produce these fish and send them out and sell them in the markets. So Mary Magdalene, yeah, Magdalene, it wasn't her last name. Sorry if you thought that. It's not like Jeremy Kuhn. Mary Magdalene. It's kind of like Jeremy of Pensacola, right? Jeremy Pensacolian. That's Mary Magdalene, Mary the Magdalene. She also, we know through Scripture, stayed by Jesus' side. She traveled everywhere he went. She participated in what he taught. And she was actively supporting his ministry. What else do we know? She also was who Jesus revealed himself first. Isn't that interesting? He chose a woman to reveal himself first. We know she was also present at the foot of the cross throughout the entire crucifixion process. We know she also accompanied Mary, Jesus' mother, the other Mary, and I would say probably provided comfort for her, because you remember it was prophesied through Simeon the prophet to Mary, the mother of Jesus, that not only would she give birth to the Son of God, but a sword would pierce her own soul too, meaning this horrible anguish of losing this child. And we know she was tormented. Now, personally, I can't show validity to the chosen as far as this was completely textual. But man, I love it. And here's what I love about it. I love that they played off the idea of names. What the producers and the writers of the show did is they took a few different scriptures. They took the one from Jeremiah. They spoke into this idea that God has a purpose for her, that she is special. And then obviously calling her by her real name. Now there's another clip, and I don't have it. It was too hard to get. But one of the things that this show starts off with that's so beautiful is this child playing with this doll. And the father is talking obviously to a very young Mary of Magdala. And he is talking to her about her name. And in this moment in the show, when Jesus calls her Mary of Magdala, it's the first time she's heard that name in a long time and verified it. It's beautiful. But I want to point out, too, the validity of something that Jesus has alluded to, at least in this clip. And that comes from John chapter 10. Jesus says that he knows his sheep by name. If you want to turn there, you can follow along with me. The words will not be on the screen for this reading. John chapter 10, verse 1. Jesus is speaking to the Pharisees, and he says, "Very truly, I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber." Now, pause. Give me your attention for a second. Jesus is alluding to the fact that there are many others who will claim to be special, but they're not special. They're basically wolves among sheep. Verse 2. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought them out, all his own, he goes on ahead of them. And his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Sheep are perhaps the weirdest animal known to man. They literally are dumb creatures. Their wool grows so thick, if they're not shorn, if they're not cut, they will grow to a place where their fur can become entangled in brush, or if they go to drink, can become engorged with water, and the sheep either pass away from being entangled or they pass away from drowning. It is necessary for a Bedouin shepherd, even in modern day Israel, to guard his sheep. When you're driving upward toward Jerusalem from the desert floor near the Dead Sea, one of the things that you'll notice in the hills there that's very odd are grooves. There are all these grooves. And what those are the pathways that sheep, the same sheep, have worn as they graze over these hills. It looks like, almost like if you were to go to China and see these rice fields that are cut into a mountain, like stairs, they're level. That's the way it looks. Sheep are creatures of habit. But there's one thing about the sheep that Jesus is pointing out, and it is that the sheep know the shepherd's voice. They know who's in charge of them. They recognize the voice. And if the voice is foreign to them, they run away from it. What is your name? What is the one thing that God has promised you that you know deep within yourself? You know, I'm gifted in this way. I have a calling in this area. I have a love for this type of life. I have a love for Jesus in this way, that you know you are capable of following there, but something has held you back, and perhaps it's because you have begun to listen to a strange voice. We talk all the time about the importance of staying in the Word and reading your Bible. We talk all the time about having a quality devotional life where you're actually literally reading the text with your own eyes and you are discerning and gaining from what the Word of God says. Isn't it interesting that another name for Jesus is Word? The Word. Everything in Scripture talks about the importance of growing in our relationship with Jesus by staying in the Word, by allowing the Word to teach us, the Word to inform us. We live in a day and age where I'm afraid that is no longer the case. We care more about what others say about what the Word says. We put more stock there than we put in the Word. I'm not against commentaries. I'm not against studying about what other people think the Word says. I'm not against studying what other people who are linguistic scholars, Hebrew scholars, Greek scholars, say what the Word originally says. That's important. It's important to know. But ultimately, I derive the truth from what the Word of God says, from what it says. It speaks to me. And the more it speaks to me, the more I'm familiar with its voice. If it is not speaking to me, I am unfamiliar to its voice. And the Bible says of sheep, by the way, that is an acronym for those who are followers of Jesus. Those who are followers recognize his voice and follow him. I'm afraid when it comes to modern day hills, we don't wear grooves in the side of the hills. Matter of fact, we just take all sorts of pathways because we believe that there are many pathways to God, and that we can just follow that pathway to God, and it'll be fine, and I can find truth here, and I can find truth there. And I had truth for a moment until this person said they didn't believe in that truth, and now I have this truth. And the text says this, I know what it says, but this person says that text doesn't say that, so then I have to believe what this person says, and this person. And the next thing you know, we don't have any theological backbone. We don't have any doctrinal belief system. We don't have anything because it's all been unraveled by somebody who gives you misinformation. Every single one of us, including myself, fall prey to this. We fill our minds with more junk than we do the Word. We know what's going on in the lives of our friends through Facebook and social media more so than we know what went on in the Old and New Testament. And then the whisper that comes in, the name that God gives us is shame. Shame. I hear it all the time from adults. They're like, you know, I mean, I'm amazed at what some of these kids are taught in Bible school. I don't even know those stories. It's like one of those things where when social media began to be a thing, and I was doing youth ministry at the time, and my teenagers would get in trouble, right? So one of my teenagers would get in trouble, and they'd say something. I don't know how they found out about that. Because you put it on Facebook with a picture, with an arrow that you drew yourself, that said, you did this. I don't know how they found out about that. I mean, sometimes things are so blatantly obvious that they're easy to figure out. And therefore, they tattle on themselves. And then they get in trouble for it. We tattle on ourselves all the time. Well, I know reading the Bible is important, but I'm not a reader. Well, guess what you just told me? What did you just tell me? I'm not a reader. For ain't no chance I'm going to be reading this. It's got words like Magdalene in it. I don't even know what Magdalene is. It sounds like a stalactite. I know something about caves, though. I go all these cave tours. I know what stalagmite is. You ever seen that bacon ribbon kind of stuff that's in the tops of caves? I know what that is. I know a lot about fauna. I plant my garden. I can tell you what kind of tree that is, what kind of leaf that is, what kind of nut that is. I can tell you everything. I'm telling you, y'all a bunch of nuts. I can tell you about snakes, and I can tell you about fishing, and I can tell you about, we're all professionals at something. Boy, how I wish we could all say that we are professionals with the Word of God. Amen. Let's dispel a myth. Being a pro with the Word doesn't mean that you have figured it out. Being a pro with the Word of God does not mean that you alone have absolutely grasped truth and you have it and nobody else does. Being a pro with the Word means you are actively involved in it. It is speaking to your soul. It is convicting you of sin. It is showing you Jesus. And as it shows you Jesus, you're inspired by the Holy Spirit that dwells inside of you, the temple of the Holy Spirit that holds the presence of God in your life, and it motivates you to change. It motivates you to become the name that God gave you. What do you hate most about yourself? Chances are, that's a name the enemy has convinced you that you are. Where does it start? How do I get in my Word? Well, I remember in Indianapolis, I'd grown up in church my whole life, and I'd known all these stories, and I knew all this stuff, and I remember I was at this broken point in my life, and I had this like kiddie new International Version Bible that my mom had bought me with pictures, because I guess she didn't think much of my intelligence at that time. And so I remember opening up, and I think I've told you this before. I guess I'll start in Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. Apparently, everybody begat everybody. And I don't even know how to pronounce these names. I remember I was immediately intimidated. I'm like, I can't even remember that. I can't remember anything. There's no way I can grow in my truth. There's no way I can grow. But the bottom line is, when I started, When I was finally convinced that it was important, all of a sudden something happened within my heart that said, I'm not satisfied with this story. I'm not satisfied with this truth. I want to know more about truth. I want to know more about Jesus. And so I started studying about Jesus. And the more I started studying about Jesus and just Jesus, I didn't get into a lot of the Pauline epistles and all the letters and all that other stuff, and definitely didn't touch Revelation. Woo! That would have frightened me off. I just studied about Jesus. And from the relationship I listened to, I heard the voice of the shepherd. It wasn't audible, but it was familiar. And familiarity bred within me a desire, a hunger to thirst for more. That's the process. It's not rocket science. There is no way you can be successful in your marriage if you ignore each other till your dying days. It just won't happen. But the more you pour into your marriage, the more you die to yourself and place the needs of your spouse in front of you, the more you convince them that you care for their heart and they care for yours, and the more you love on them, and the more you surprise them, and the more you honor and cherish them, areas we are all weak in. The more you do that stuff, the more your marriage will flourish. Why? Because you are honoring God in that commitment. You're honoring your commitment to your spouse, and your spouse knows that you care. If we never get in the Word of God, how do we expect to grow in our relationship with God? How are we expected to know that He knows our name? I mean, what does that mean, He knows my name? It means three things. It means this one, and first and foremost, you are not alone. You're not alone. Regardless of how alone you feel, you are not alone. I firmly believe that God has a purpose for everything. I really do. I don't understand it. I don't get it. Sometimes I'm mad at it, but I don't get it. Last week, what you didn't know was that we had a guest in our home. I guess you did know it. I asked you to pray for it a few weeks ago, but we had a guest in our home who recently lost his wife. I had prepared my sermon last week. Think about that. If you were here, you remember. I talked about the fact that there was nothing in the world that should be able to separate us from God. That God has us in our deepest, darkest moments, and He wants us to know that He's there. And I'm sitting here having to preach this sermon. I even gave a disclaimer, technically for him, because I didn't want to think I had created this sermon aiming straight for him. Now, how do you explain that? I created a sermon a week prior. We found out during that week that he was coming to stay with us. He came and stayed with us, and then I had to preach that sermon that I had prepared before I knew he was coming, that spoke specifically to him. You telling me God does not work today? He does. You're telling me that you feel alone? Chances are you're the one that walked away. Chances are you're the one that stopped believing. Chances are you let the first doubt unravel your faith. Chances are that first doubt unraveled your faith because you hadn't been spending a lot of time building up your faith. There's a term that I have always wanted to use from stage, but I would lose my job if I used it. First time I ever heard it, my grandfather said it to me. Actually, it's my pawpaw. My grandfather was the preacher. He was holy. My pawpaw, who would eventually be holy, was not holy when he said it. Most of you say it to your kids, so technically I could say it. Technically. Jennifer, should I say it? You don't know? No. Jennifer says, no, I shouldn't say it. Maybe I should say it. No, I'm not going to say it. No, I'm going to say it. No, I'm not going to say it. Let's just say, I'll say it another way. He would tell me when I was helping him clean out his barn, son, don't halfway do it.
You got it? You got it? Half. You know what? Hee-haw, hee. You don't understand? You understand? You get me? You with me? I didn't say it. I did not say it. But he would say, don't halfway do it. You give it all or nothing. I want everything you got. And if you didn't give Papaw everything you got it. He would fulfill it. You know what I'm saying? Papaw was mean. Sometimes I wish God would just from the heavens open the skies and go, hey, Ronnie, quit halfway doing it. Ronnie's like, I'm not halfway doing it. I wish you would just say that. I wish sometimes we could just have the audible word that just said, don't halfway do it. I wish something would just shout to us, give everything you've got, build a relationship with Jesus. I wish something had the boldness to say that to us. If God would just whisper it. I mean, if he'd just give me a sign. If he would just, maybe over the radio, maybe he has been. Maybe he has been. And we don't hear it because we're not tuned in. Second truth. You have been called by God and set apart for him according to his purpose. That sounds like a scripture. It is. It was the scripture that was given to Jeremiah the prophet. But guess what? Just like that scripture was given to Jeremiah the prophet, it is also spoken over you. Jesus says, I have called you by name. My sheep know my voice. If those sheep know his voice, it means that they are intent on following him. Folks, we need more followers of Jesus. We need more people who believe that Jesus called you by name. If you're sitting here today, chances are something has spoken to your heart to say that there's a need to be here, but also maybe if you're visiting, maybe if you're just passing through, maybe whatever. Maybe there's a purpose that God has you here right now, and it's to hear this message. That you have a purpose, a holy and righteous church God-honoring purpose, that you can do amazing things if you just pour it all out to Jesus. And finally this, you can only fulfill those purposes if you follow the voice of him who knows you. You might be able to do some cool things in the world. You might be able to bless a lot of people, but let me tell you something. I have never had the fulfillment I have experienced in my life by doing something that I know honors God. One of the great things my dad did growing up was kind of like what you guys are participating in. We would wake up on Christmas morning. We did this like 5 years in a row. And Christmas morning, we would open our presents, and then Dad would drive us to some section of town that was absolutely awful, just this horrible slum place. And Dad, through his business, had decided he was going to give, you know, they would amass these gifts, very much like you've done for the foster families, but it would be for one specific family. And we had this one guy named Darren who worked with my dad at the funeral home. He was a weightlifter. He was enormous, right? And I remember one time Darren dressed up like a jolly red fella with a white beard. Maybe children in here. I'm being careful. And I remember we'd get out, and he'd start saying all his Saint Nick phrases, and we'd walk in, and the kids would pile out of the house, many of them in diapers, many of them in full diapers, and they would come out, and the house was a wreck. I remember going in a couple of trailers that had holes in the floor, and you could look through and see dirt. And I remember thinking to myself, these kids have no hope. These kids have no hope. And I remember seeing their eyes as they got excited about what was happening. And I remember it wasn't the fact that I felt like we were giving these gifts to these kids and that was wonderful, or seeing the magic of Saint Nick or Christmas happen. And I remember what amazed me and what made me feel so special was, this is what God is calling us to do, and my dad is allowing us to do this,
to partner with him to see this. And we'd throw a little Nerf football or whatever it was we had back then with the kids for a couple hours or maybe an hour or so. And then we'd hop back in the Cadillac, my grandfather's Cadillac. That's all he ever drove. 30-foot long boat of a car. And we would drive back to the house into the warmth of our homes, surrounded by love. And I just felt good on the inside. When was the last time you just felt really good on the inside? Good because you knew that you were part of God's plan. Good because you knew that God was working through you. Good because you believed that the promise of the Holy Spirit was working inside of you. Good because it wasn't you that was doing all of it. It was God that had given you the opportunity, and he's getting the glory, and you're just a part of it, and you're along for the ride. If you hear nothing else today, hear this. God knows your name. He believes in you. He gifted you. All he asks is for you to spend time with him and become familiar with his voice. I pray that after today, we might do more of that. Spend more time with him. Get to know his voice. Maybe there's some of you here who have not heard that voice in a long time. Well, you could start that today. Maybe there are those of you here who have never been the sheep or the lost sheep that experienced, from another parable, experienced this calling on your life and said you were going to give it all to the Lord and follow him. I'd love to begin talking with you about that journey, about baptism. But whatever your need is this morning, please let it be known as we stand and while we sing.
For all that you've done, I will thank you. For all that you're going to do. For all that you promised and all that you are is all that has carried me through. My Jesus, I thank you. And I thank you. Thank you, Lord. And I thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for loving and setting me free. Thank you for giving your life just for me.
Father, we thank you for walking with us in good times and in bad, for shelter and safe spaces. We thank you when we have more than we need and when we struggle to get by. We thank you for how your creation leaves us in awe wherever we look. We thank you through the adventures and the everyday routines. We thank you for friendships and family, for laughter, comfort, and warmth. We thank you for new beginnings and closed doors. We thank you for the times when we should build and when we should start over. As seasons change and we walk into an uncertain future, we cling to you, the one who holds it all in your hands, from beginning to end, from death to life, from shattered to saved. We thank you.
Well, it is on there, guys. We have had quite a few handed in today, and for those of you who know, this process of what we're going to be doing is actually begin changing next week. I know you've seen the prayer stations. We've been talking about them for some time. Next week, those stations will be manned. And what that means is, after the invitation and everything is done, or during the invitation, actually, if you need prayer for something, you need to turn in a prayer request, they can be done at those as well as the front, but we won't be reading all of them at one time as they accumulate and get very, very busy. And more importantly, we have actual prayer that's happening in that moment rather than just reading this. And it will be emailed out to the entire Nemail team directly following services so that more than just a few of us will be praying for them during that time. So let me do this way. I've got three announcements that I need to make really quick. It's really one, but we'll do that. The last Next Step class for the year is next Sunday, December 5th at 9 o'clock in the morning in the gym. That happens over here. That's the Next Steps class. The class is for anyone interested in placing membership or just wants to know more about Gateway. If you do, Seth does an awesome job with that class. Head to the gym at 9 a.m. next Sunday, and you'll be treated to history and all the fun stuff that Gateway is and will be in the future, and it's a very, very good, well-done class. We've had lots of visitors, so this is the first step in placing membership and seeing how we define membership. I know there's a lot of question and debate about that, and so if you want to be a part of that process, plan on showing up there at 9 a.m. next Sunday. Okay, here are the prayers turned in today. Priscilla asks for her sister-in-law, Linda, and family that lives in Chattahoochee. Her stepmother is on life support. Her father, Lou Shepherd, is still in need of prayer, and her sister, Tammy, and another relative assisting their father need prayer for supporting him. Martha Rudolph lost her youngest son, Kenneth Rudolph, Thursday on Thanksgiving. He passed away from pneumonia and issues around that, so we need to be praying for her. Tom Perdue has been diagnosed with diverticulitis, and Dixie Fonda has been struggling with her blood pressure recently. Eric Dotlich, Margie's son, is just going through some difficult times in his life right now with life changes, and she is asking for prayers in support of him. Amy Geis, who's a friend of Bo Farley, works with Bo, has family members who were in a horrible car wreck. All four are in surgery or have had surgery. Please pray for that family. We'll definitely be doing that. Of course, Carol Beaver, who passed away, be praying for her husband, Terry, as well as the Pace Church of Christ, who's dealing with that loss. Amy Ray and family writes, Dear Gateway brothers and sisters, 23 years ago, my father went to the emergency room on Thanksgiving Day because of a kidney stone. While there, a mass was found in his abdomen that turned out to be non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. It was stage 4 and in his blood. Many prayers went up on his behalf, and to God's glory, he went into chemo and into remission. He was given 7 to 8 years at best to remain in remission, and he made it more than 20 years. This week, a biopsy was performed on a new mass in his abdomen. Please pray for his family and friends as we await the results. Pray for peace and comfort and another miracle, most of all, Pray for God's glory to be shown no matter what the outcome. Thank you and love you all, Amy Ray and family. And then we had one more prayer request. Poor old Ed was trying to write these down before we got up here. And I was like, man, you're not going to do it. It's a bunch. Dear church family, this is anonymous. Says, I'm requesting prayers for my family. We are experiencing difficulties we cannot handle on our own. We are believers in God's love and in the power of prayer. God knows what our family needs. We pray for his guidance, his love, his direction. We need the direction to be loud and clear. So all of these prayers have been handed in, and we will send those out on an email today for those to be prayed over for the week. That's a lot of heavy stuff that's going on right now. So Ed Jerzak, one of our elders, is going to come up and come to that microphone. He's going to pray for these prayers as well as for our week. And I hope you guys had a blessed time with us today. Ed.
Let's go to our Father in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this community of believers here who gather to glorify and honor you, Lord. And we're thankful that you are our Father, that you call us by a name that you've given us to be your children. And we're thankful to know that our names are written in your book of life. I never cease to be amazed, God, at your great love for us, and never cease to be thankful for the mercy and the compassion that you show to us. Always thankful, Lord, but appreciate this time of year when the world pauses and thinks in appreciation of the things that we've been blessed with. And I'm thankful for the season, Lord, that for many people highlights you in a way that they maybe don't highlight you most of the rest of the year. And we pray, Lord, that you're glorified and people who just maybe know you in passing get to know you more deeply, Lord, through this season that we celebrate Thanksgiving for all the rich bounty that we enjoy. Many, many people, Lord, that we're going to lift up this morning, and I won't list all of the things that they need, Lord, because I know that you know what they need. You know better than we, and we know that even in our inexpressiveness, that the Holy Spirit intercedes for us to say what we in our inadequacies can't often express. But I want to be especially mindful of Eric today, Lord, Tom Perdue, Amy Geis's family, the extended family of Priscilla and their needs. A special prayer for the Rudolph family in the death of their son, for Terry Beaver, that your compassion, that your spirit of peace will envelop them in the loss of their loved ones, that you give the consolation, Lord, that only that you can give to them. I'm sure, Lord, that I'm missing others. We have an extended list in the bulletin. Many, many people who need prayers, who need blessings. And we know, Lord, that you'll pour your blessings out on them. We just continue to try to remember those people. Help us to be alert, Lord, to the ways that we can serve people, not just through spoken prayer, but in other physical means, that those people will be aided and that you'll be glorified in the process, Lord. We try to do everything, Lord, to glorify your name. Continue to be thankful for all the ways you richly bless us, Lord. We're thankful for this season that honors and glorifies you. We ask that you go with us through this coming week, that we serve and glorify you in all that we do. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.